I'm Dr. Elizabeth Edgerly. I'm the Chief Program Officer for the Alzheimer's Association, and it's really awesome to be here with 550 people. It's amazing to us. We've done this so many years. Thank you. Thank you for being here. It's my honor to be able to introduce our next speaker. Dr. Alireza Atri is the Ray Dolby Endowed Chair in Brain Health Research at California Pacific Medical Center in San Francisco. He's a visiting faculty member also from Harvard Medical School. A cognitive neurologist, Dr. Atri specializes in diagnostics, experimental therapeutics, and care of individuals with memory disorders and dementia, particularly those with early stage cognitive impairments and younger onset Alzheimer's. Dr. Atri holds degrees from UCLA. He has a PhD in biomathematics. From UCSF, he has his medical degree, and Harvard Medical School, he has a degree, I don't know what this means, MMSC, so you'll have to explain to me what that is, Ali, and completed postgraduate training in clinical and research fellowships at Harvard Medical School, Boston University, and also MIT. This is a very smart individual, clearly. From 2001 to 2015, Dr. Atri served on the neurology faculty of Mass General Hospital and Harvard Medical School. And I just want to say a word about Ali. I got to meet Ali last year when he came to Northern California to work with our friends and partners at the Ray Dolby Brain Health Center. And his background is incredible, his knowledge is incredible, but what I want to say is his heart is also really amazing. He's been a caregiver for his father, and it comes across just so clearly. Many of us have walked this journey with our parents and with others we love, and Ali hasn't escaped that as well. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Ali Atri.
Thank you, Dr. Edgerly, for that very kind introduction. It's an honor to be here with you today, and thank you for inviting me. I'm a neurologist. I take care of patients and families. I also do a lot of education and research. And I'll apologize up front. There's a lot of material here, and you have more slides in there than I'm going to show. Some of the slides are a bit tweaked, and it's a bit technical. But we'll try to make it a bit more commonsensical. Let's see. These are my disclosures. I'm not part of a speakers bureau. These slides are my own. I'm involved in research, and I do advise companies about how to do clinical trials, basically, because we really do need better therapies. I'm also a walker and a talker, so I feel constrained up here. So if you see me walking around, I haven't disappeared. I always start my talks with this quote: human beings are members of a whole, in creation of one essence and soul. If one member is afflicted with pain, other members uneasy will remain. If you have no sympathy for human pain, the name of human you cannot retain. And this is as true now as it was 850 years ago in Persia and Iran. And this is to ground us, because there is going to be a lot of scientific stuff coming, and p-values and PET scans and all this kind of stuff. But you know what? It's about people. And this is a disease that affects people. Not just the individual, but the whole family, the whole environment around them. And I want you to get a sense of what we're doing and that of what hope there is. So bear that in mind. I show you this, and as a scientist, I can say it's 50% by volume, or I could say it's 50 mLs, plus or minus 0.5 mLs of water in 100 SEC glass. And again, after all this, I want you to make your own decision about where we stand with things. As an overview, the prevalence and cost of dementia are increasing. We'll talk a little bit about that. There's no new treatment since 2003, unfortunately, and there have been many failed clinical trials. And one of the things I'm going to tell you is that it's a complex situation. We're not going to have a magic bullet. It doesn't mean that we can't incrementally do better, just like we've done in other diseases, in other conditions. Over the last 15 years, there's been an incredible understanding of what goes into this condition and looking at some of the risk factors for it and measuring it. We still need to understand more, but we'll talk about things like biomarkers and how we may be using those in clinical trials now. And the converging evidence is that over the last, basically, people don't wake up one morning with dementia, right? It's a process that occurs over 15 to 20 years. And there are factors, as you heard, about vulnerabilities and resilience. And people can have these abnormal proteins in their brain but not manifest the condition. Why is that? We need to learn from the people who have, you know, have that resilience. And how can we increase it with all the things that, Dr. Henderson talked about in a multimodal way, multiple things together with minimal risk? So many, many roads lead to Rome, and there are many pathways that converge to this organ failure syndrome of Alzheimer's disease. So the treatments aren't going to be one thing, and they're not going to be easy. But because there's this long preclinical phase, this phase where people can have the risks and they're building up, guess what? That's an opportunity for us to intervene during those phases too. So I think that's really, really important. And in the future, we're going to be doing it with combinations.
Yes.
So you heard a bit about prevention, which is very, very important, and I think in itself is a big topic. And I'll broadly review where we stand with current therapeutics, because we have to know where we are now, what are the expectations of the current treatments, and then I'll talk a little bit about what's in the pipeline that is going to potentially disease modify as well as symptomatic medications. Okay. No person is an island entirely of itself. Any person's death diminishes me because I'm involved in mankind, and therefore never sent to know for whom the bell tolls. It tolls for thee. As Dr. Ezerly told you, none of us are going to escape this. I was a caregiver to my aunt, who was like a mother to me when I was in graduate school. That's my father. Took care of him at home for over a decade. He died 2 months ago. So, from that perspective, we really have to do better for our children. Even if not for ourselves, for our children. All right. Far sight. Breaks the heaviness. Say, Bob, what's a mountain goat doing way up here in a cloud bank? When these pilots crash, it's not just going to be the pilots that are going to get hurt. Unfortunately, we have a rising epidemic. Alzheimer's disease is the sixth leading cause of death. It's the only one, 66%, that's going up. Currently, about 5.3 million people in the U.S., 5.3 to 6 million. Those numbers are going to triple over the next 30 to 40 years. And it's the same thing in the world. About 47 million people in the world. Estimates are it's going to be about 140, 150 million over the next 20 or 30 years. And the costs are enormous. Currently anywhere from $220 to $250 billion, a lot of it is, that's not even in there, is on how caregivers take care of folks and all the costs associated with that. And the estimates, if we don't do something about this in the next 20 years, 30 to 40 to 50% of Medicare dollars are going to go into dementia care. So these are the risk factors. As you know, you can lie about some of them, but you can't change them. But some of them you can. So potentially, again, we don't know if it's going to change the pathology in your brain, but could it delay symptoms? And each one of these slides, I lead a course at Harvard in June. It's 4 days. It's 8 a.m. to 10 p.m. And I can tell you, a couple of these slides are a topic of a whole hour in the course. So just so you know, some of the things here, there's data regarding, a potentially mediating risk in folks. But the big thing is down there is that cerebral amyloidosis, having this abnormal protein in your brain, that somehow is critically involved. We don't know if it's the cause, but it's critically involved. And a lot of the therapies that we've been looking into has to do with that. Now, that's potentially been part of our failures, too, because there's many other things involved. So you, at some point, start with a normal brain, and you have some genetic risk. And over time, what we've learned is that these proteins here, amyloid protein, which is a normal protein in the brain, that in people who are have early onset, who have very genetic, very aggressive types of Alzheimer's, they're overproducing it. In the older types, the most prevalent kind of Alzheimer's disease, the late onset, sporadic, it's probably we can't get rid of it as well. Okay, so it accumulates. As they accumulate, before they even get into these plaques, Alzheimer's plaques, they also go, they stick together and they cause problems with synapses, these connections between brain cells. And ultimately, there's something that leads to this other protein, tau, which is a scaffolding protein inside of neurons. For it to be hyperphosphorylized and then literally kind of strangles the neurons from inside. So that's one pathway, but ultimately, as you heard, there's a lot of coexisting issues. People who age over time have their blood vessels are affected. So they accumulate a whole bunch of different types of things that are related to microvascular damage. That also leads to activation of inflammatory pathways. And so there are very few things in life that are binary, like Alzheimer's disease or vascular cognitive impairment. You know, most people fall somewhere in between over time. And ultimately, what happens is that there's dysregulation of neurotransmitters, there's castellate dysregulation, glucose metabolism is off, we have energy failure inside cells, and then we find people at these stages when they've done something bad with a car, with behavior. Okay, so it's kind of late in the course. What we've learned over the last probably 10, 15 years is that we can measure some of these biomarkers. So we can measure, for example, these abnormal proteins in the brain. How do we do that? So one of the ways is through spinal fluid, getting a lumbar puncture. The other way is through this thing called amyloid PET, so PET scans, okay? So we can get a picture of it. I'll show you some pictures of it later on. But basically, this is supposed to be an early event, 10, 15, 20 years before people actually show symptoms. Then, after that, there are some other things that happen that are neurodegenerative. So you end up having problems with synaptic function, these connections between the brain cells. And you can actually measure that through another kind of PET scan called a glucose PET scan. There's neuronal injury. So remember that tau protein I told you, the scaffolding protein? You can also measure that from the spinal fluid now. Okay, and now there's experimental ways that you can see it in a PET scan. Okay, ultimately, what happens is that as there's more and more and more destruction on MRIs, you can actually see shrinkage in particular areas of the brain. Okay, and the thought is that as you progress over time, here, this is time, and this is abnormality, at first you get issues with these abnormal proteins, the amyloid proteins, then you have issues. You know, the timing could be different. It could be tau protein or synaptic function, but you can actually see that on with measures like PET scans and spinal fluid. And then you get structural changes in MRIs, for example. Ultimately, you start having problems with memory tests in daily life. And you can actually, if we test you according to your age and education, we can say, you know, your scores are going off a little bit. And ultimately, we've been diagnosing people in this dementia stage. But the idea is, you know, if we can get people in these stages and figure out who's at risk, just like the cardiologists did for all these different years, high blood pressure, high cholesterol, are those diseases? No, they're risk factors, right? We treat people. We give them statin medications or a combination of blood pressure medications so we can decrease an event years from now. And not everyone who has those risk factors actually goes on to have a stroke or a heart attack, okay? All right. So these are the scans I was going to show you. These are pretty pictures of these amyloid scans, and red is worse. And we have several of them that are approved now by the FDA. They're approved, but they're incredibly expensive. Okay, $4,000, $5,000, $6,000. Currently, there's a study ongoing that we're part of, and I'm sure many other. I'm sure Stanford's part of also, called the IDEA study. So we're trying to figure out actually if you do these tests in people where you're not quite sure what their cause of cognitive impairment is, and figure out if they have amyloid, will it change their management? Will it decrease costs? So that's an ongoing study. This is what I call the 50 Shades of Gray picture, because What happens with them? We don't get these pretty pictures. When we're trying to read these scans, you're actually looking at the difference between these gray areas inside and in the cortex. And basically, amyloid stuck to the cortex is the bad kind. Okay. So primary prevention means, you know what? They don't have symptoms. They don't have the stuff. Can we ultimately look at these folks years before they have any pathology and give them something to modify their risk? Now, I'm not going to go through Dr. Henderson's whole presentation, but what I can say is that, you know, maybe lowering risk through targeted activities or nutraceuticals, okay? That's a whole topic. What are disease-modifying drugs? These are the kind of things that you want to give probably during secondary prevention, really, really early on. They are targeted those amyloid proteins, okay? Decreasing their production, decreasing their toxicity of sticking together, taking them away through antibodies, sucking them out of the brain, or looking at those tau proteins, making them less hyper, not having them be hyperphosphorylated, or even attacking other things like inflammation cascades, mitochondria, which is the power cells inside of neurons, the power factories. So, and then ultimately, symptomatic medication. Symptomatic medications are the kinds we have now, okay? They treat symptoms, they probably work on neurotransmitters, and I'll tell you a little bit about our expectations for the current medications, and then a few things that are in the works for the future. But there are a number of different neurotransmitters that are dysregulated. And as people progress, they're going to need symptomatic medications also for symptoms. There are all these other strategies like neuroprotection and regeneration and stem cells and things like that. They're a bit more far down the line. Okay, so I told you about this amyloid protein. It's cut by a few different enzymes. So you, guess what? You can block those. Okay, so that's one method you can go about it. You can prevent them from sticking together. You can potentially use antibodies, both passive and active, to try to neutralize them and take them out of the brain. Or you can decrease their toxicity. And all these different ways are targets, right, for pharmaceutical companies and for other folks interested to attack this condition. The other part is to look at that tau protein and to decrease this hyperphosphorylation so it won't end up strangling neurons like this in these tangles. Okay. Tertiary prevention is what we, for the most part, are doing now. It means, you know what, they've had the organ failure syndrome of the brain of the Alzheimer's type, and, you know, it's far down the line. What can we do? We can basically give them medications that affect neurotransmitters for the most part. Okay, so this part, because we're talking about pharmacology so much, about treatments, I don't want to neglect the fact that there's a whole other aspect to this of current treatment. You can have the best laid plans, but guess what? There are four things you need to basically do to effectively treat people. And I call it sort of like my analogy of having a chair. You need all the different legs of the chair to make it work. The first one is early detection. Guess what? If I don't diagnose you, I can't give you the care you need, okay? And guess what? This whole thing by itself is a huge issue in our culture. We need more education publicly. We need more education of the frontline clinicians that see people. And there's a fair amount of data that shows you catch people early, give the support systems they need, and you delay the end stages much more, and you save costs. So that's really, really important. And the other part is that it really has to be individualized. The other part is non-pharmacological intervention. So I don't want to give a sense that it's all pharmacology. It isn't. Actually, a lot of it has to do with psychoeducation, telling people about what the process is. Why is it that the individual is acting in the way due? They're not just being ornery. It's the disease. And how do you approach that? God bless all the care coordinators and social workers here and all the people who do this type of work, because it's very, very important. People ask me, what do you actually, you know, if you had money to spend, what do you do? I say, on the diagnostic side, you know, don't go into these fancy stuff.
if you can't do it yourself, do a neuropsychological evaluation. Have a good neuropsychologist. On the care side, have a good care manager. Those are the most important things. The rest of it is not rocket science right now, I can tell you that much. Pharmacological interventions. Guess what? The first thing I do isn't give medicines. I actually take away medicines. People drift. They get a whole bunch of things that get added on. Nobody takes responsibility for actually managing those things. Oftentimes, half of those things can actually be risky for the brain. Okay, they get on benzodiazepines, and they go on things like Benadryl or diphenhydramine. All those things are actually not good. They sedate people. They make them more confused. They're on medicines to actually make them sleep and then wake up at the same time. You know, it's so I take that. That's actually a big part of it. Next is we use clinically approved medications. I will explain to you what those are. But basically, our paradigm is a slow decline. We have cholinesterase inhibitors, like donepezil, rivastigmine, and galantamine. We have one thing called memantine, which we usually add on. And then there's data for vitamin E also from randomized clinical trials. But that one's not approved by the FDA. And then judicially, in a judicious way, we may have to use other medications. We'll talk about that. But ultimately, this is the glue. The glue is actually caregivers. And you have to have that glue. If you end up writing the best prescription and it can't be implemented because of lack of knowledge, because of other things, because the environment is not right for it, then guess what? You can have that amazing car with a big engine and everything else, but you don't have the tires. That's where the rubber hits the road. Okay. All right. What are the current medications? Basically, as I mentioned to you, we have cholinesterase inhibitors that affect this chemical called acetylcholine. And right now, this morning, talk like this, you're getting sleepy. And if I talk like this, the acetylcholine levels come up and your attention comes up. So this is a chemical that facilitates processing and wakefulness, okay? And three different flavors, and all of them can be found generically except for the patch. Then there's this other medicine called memantine that's added on. It works on a different chemical called glutamate that's very, very important in memory and learning and also in toxicity. And it tends to be added on. There's generic form of that now also. Okay? Then non-approved drugs. What do? Sometimes we have to give antidepressants. Sometimes antipsychotics. There's a black box warning on this one. Okay? In Europe, one of the antipsychotics is approved. But again, we have about half a day at least when we talk about these medicines in our course. So I can't go through the whole nuances of it. But resist unless you really, really have to. But sometimes you have to. Vitamin E, about 20%, 90 to 20% decline in function. So it decreases the decline in activity of daily living. Okay, it doesn't do as much for cognition. Two randomized trials have shown that. Don't give it in people who have hemorrhages in their brain or have bleeding risk. Okay, but it's not FDA approved. All these other things, unfortunately, I've been involved in many of them. In the dementia stage, but when you have that organ failure, they haven't worked in groups of people. Then there's these medical foods, much lower evidence burden for them, much lower efficacy. I generally don't use them, and there's no data to say that they're any better or not even as nearly as efficacious as the drugs that we have now. Generically, what do these things kind of look like? As Dr. Henderson said, you know, the clinical trials are the sort of like the gold standard of doing stuff. Randomized, double-blinded, placebo-controlled trials, right? The issue is that's an experimental setting. That's not real life. We pick and choose who we want in these trials. If you're not compliant, we kick you out. Things like that, right? Those are very, very protocol things. And generally, for clinical trials, they've been about 6 months, sometimes 12 months. And they show this pattern. You have basically, whether it's cognition, function, or behavior, or global severity, those are the things we try to measure. Cognition, function, behavior, very, very important, probably the most important, and global severity. Generally, what happens is the patients on placebo may even get a bump in the beginning, believe it or not. But then over 6 months, on average, they decline. That's important to know. On average, patients with Alzheimer's disease over 6 months on chronic treatments or no treatments will decline, okay? So guess what? If they're stable for 6 months or 12 months on average, that's a win. Generally, you end up getting this, depending on which measure your use, especially cognition. The medicines tend to boost people on average. On average, they're about the same or a little bit higher at 6 months or even 12 months on average. But then there's a group of 30 to 40% of people who also will decline over that course of the year overall. Effectiveness is what we do in real life. Okay, we can't randomize people. So what we do is we have these long-term studies that are observational, but they're prospective. So they're actually prospective studies, and usually in clinical settings, in memory centers, things like that. And they can go on for several years. Based on that data, I can show you that, for example, this is our data from Mass General at our Alzheimer's Center, where we basically looked at hundreds of people over several years. And this is the number of years. This is a cognitive score. And if they were on standard of care but not the medications, they basically declined like that on average. Okay, on average. If they're on one medicine, cholinesterase inhibitors, they basically declined like that on average. If they're on two medicines, they basically decline like that. So I told you early on there can actually be some stabilization and improvement. Okay, but overall, if you've got the diagnosis right, then people are going to decline over years. And you're better off being on one medicine than no medicines, and ultimately two medicines than no medicines. But that's our paradigm now. What else? Well, this is not, again, this was the Alzheimer's Center study, non-pharma. Same thing here. Another ADRC study from Pittsburgh showed that basically if you're on one medicine versus two medicines, your risk of being in a nursing home over several years is less. Okay, so two medicines do better than one medicine. Okay? This was a study from Baylor that said that basically over years and years and years, if you're more persistent to taking the medicines, okay, just don't go on and off, don't take it for 6 months, but you're more persistent,
don't believe what you're
saying. Your decline is less. It's worth about a point and a half on the mini mental, basically, a year. Okay? And this is a study from Europe, again, and there's about five or six more of them that have been done since then that show the same thing. Basically, you're on several medicines, your decline on multiple factors tends to be less, worth about a point to point and a half a year. Recently, there was a guidance that came out from the European Federation of Neurological Sciences that basically did a whole bunch of analyses on the clinical trials, not the effectiveness ones, but even the efficacy ones, basically. And basically, they said that, you know, these drugs over the short period have small to medium effect sizes, mostly on the small side. And their conclusion basically was, we suggest the combination when they're in the right stage. Okay? What about experimental therapeutics? All right. Lots of failures, as I mentioned to you, on many different categories. Okay, unfortunately. What do we have ongoing? Ongoing, we have a bunch of medicines that affect basically this amyloid protein, sucking it out of the brain. These medicines here, BACE inhibitors, are involved in decreasing the production. Okay? So very, very exciting. We'll see. We'll know some results over the next year. And then there's a whole bunch of other things that are actually, in fact, look at inflammatory pathways. Some of them are actually cancer drugs. This one was a nice drug. Unfortunately, there was a signal for safety, so it got stopped. And I'll tell you a little bit about this symptomatic type of medicines. I'm involved in one of these trials, and it works on serotonin, okay, another chemical in the brain. All right, maybe we can hit the video. And this video is courtesy of the DETECT program. It's a CME program by Medical Learning Group that comes from an unrestricted grant from Lilly. Okay, here we go.
That's it.
There are currently four FDA-approved cholinesterase inhibitors and one FDA-approved N-methyl-D-aspartate receptor antagonist for the treatment of Alzheimer's disease. They all work by targeting disease-associated neurotransmitter abnormalities in the brain, leading to treatment-dependent symptomatic improvement in a proportion of individuals with Alzheimer's disease. In contrast, many of the new drugs in development aim to modify the disease process itself. Given the genetic evidence supporting the important role of amyloid in AD pathogenesis, new agents have been developed to inhibit the production or promote the clearance of A-beta in the attempt to limit its toxic effects. A-beta production is indeed reduced in vivo by gamma secretase inhibitors, but their clinical development was halted because of side effects due to the inhibition of the Notch transmembrane receptor, which is a crucial neuronal signaling pathway. As the beta secretase enzyme that initiates the production of A-beta, BACE1 is a key therapeutic target for AD. Several beta secretase inhibitors, including MK8931, can produce up to a 90% decrease in cerebral spinal fluid A-beta, but at the price of dose-limiting toxicities. Immunization against a prevalent A-beta peptide implicated in Alzheimer's disease pathogenesis was able to prevent the deposition of A-beta plaques in a murine model of AD. However, the phase 2 trial of the corresponding vaccine, A1792, was terminated due to a high incidence of meningoencephalitis, despite clearance of amyloid plaques. These side effects may be due to T-cell mediated responses. Second generation vaccines aim to minimize autoimmune effects by preferentially targeting B-cell response. One strategy to provide anti-A-beta antibodies without triggered T-cell mediated autoimmunity involves passive immunization with monoclonal anti-A-beta antibodies. These antibodies target different forms of A-beta with different possible mechanisms of action. Bepizumab, the humanized version of a murine antibody that binds to A-beta plaque and activates microglia phagocytosis, was shown to reduce fibrillary A-beta deposition in the brain of AD patients by imaging with amyloid PET. A notable asymptomatic side effect was the development of vasogenic edema and microhemorrhages in a number of subjects, influenced in part by higher drug doses and being a carrier of APOE4. The hypothetical mechanism for these side effects involves change in the permeability of cerebral vessels as A-beta deposits are removed. Less of these side effects have been seen with solanezumab, a humanized antibody targeting an alternate form of soluble versus plaque-bound A-beta. Solanezumab may act by decreasing plasma soluble A-beta and sequestering soluble A-beta in the CNS, a mechanism also called a peripheral sink. Although only small clinical benefits were seen in a subset of patients with mild AD, trials in asymptomatic AD and positive amyloid PET scans and prevention trials are ongoing. Crenezumab, a monoclonal antibody recognizing multiple species of A-beta. Aducanumab, which recognizes aggregated forms of A-beta. And gantenerumab, which recognizes A-beta fibrils, have not yet shown consistent benefits in modifying disease progression. Similarly, studies of intravenous immunoglobulin preparations containing naturally occurring anti-A-beta could not document any significant slowing of AD progression. Tau accumulation and phosphorylation have emerged as attractive targets because of their correlation with AD cognitive decline. Monoclonal antiphosphorylated tau antibodies and kinase inhibitors are in clinical development. Given the advent of biomarkers and genetic studies to aid early diagnosis, early intervention with disease-modifying therapies appear as a promising approach to slow disease progression.
All right. So, you heard about all our failures, basically. What have we learned? So I'll tell you, this was, so the first one was this vaccine. It turned out it did clear amyloid, but there was a lot of inflammation that meningoencephalitis was being caused, okay? So then they went back to the drawing board and said, look, it affects a certain type of a cell called a T cell. Let's not deal with that. Let's try to give you the antibody. Let's make them and give them to you. That doesn't activate those T cells. Let's go the B cell route. So the first study, I was involved in this from phase one. And I used to sit there all day giving infusions, and we didn't know what was going to happen. So I'd sit there for 8 or 10 hours and watch folks. And basically, it was a negative trial, unfortunately. What it did show, actually, was that here's the placebo, someone getting placebo, and this is amyloid. And it really didn't change the amyloid. But overall, in people who had the baconizumab, the drug, there was a lowering. Okay, this is what it showed. There was actually a lowering overall. But the issue was, there was a lowering. You could take some of this amyloid out of the brain, but there's no clinical benefit. Too late. It was too late. So basically, two large trials in mild to moderate AD, it was negative. Interestingly enough, when you actually look at the people in those trials coming in, some expert like myself said, this is Alzheimer's disease, right? And then when they did the PET scans with amyloid and things like that, 17, 20% of them, depending on their APOE status, didn't actually have amyloid in their brain. So guess what? They look like, you know, they had Alzheimer's disease, but they didn't have the hallmark amyloid. So does that mean we're stupid? Yes. Yeah. Me a little. No, it means that there's a lot of overlap, right? When, you know, that's the thing, is that this is very difficult. There's a lot of overlap in clinical phenotype and how people look. Okay? And later on, we'll get a lot smarter. With biomarkers, we can say, you know what? Your tau positive, amyloid positive, inflammation negative, you need these three kinds of drugs. But at this point, we don't have that. Okay? So one of the things they learned is that, guess what? You better actually, if you're going to give an amyloid-lowering drug that could be potentially dangerous, you better give it to people who have amyloid in their brain. That's one of the things we learned. Okay, that's good. All right. Getting a little smarter. One thing that's important to know is that 90% of people who come into these trials, we're going to take questions later, are on background therapies. So again, this idea that we're going to have combinations, right? We're going to have combinations. People are going to be on multiple medicines, and then they're going to get other stuff on top of it. As I mentioned, there was considerable dose and APOE related. So this APOE is a very important thing. APOE is a cholesterol transport protein. We have different flavors of it. And the E4 type, for some reason, increases our risk of showing symptoms earlier. If you have one of them, 8 years earlier. If you have two of them, maybe 12 to 14. In these studies, it was also associated with having more of those microhemorrhages and that edema, which is this stuff, the amyloid-related ARIA, they call it, amyloid-related imaging abnormalities, fancy term, ARIA. Basically, you could get inflammation. See this white stuff here? That's inflammation. It's a loss of autoregulation of the blood cells. You can also get hemorrhages, okay? And that's not trivial, so you have to think about a condition that can last many, many years. You don't want to make someone bad now, okay? All right, this is another negative trial, a different kind of antibody, solanezumab, okay? Several big studies, two of them, unfortunately, both of them were negative. They were done in what? Mild to moderate, okay? Expedition one and two. Again, 90% of them were on background treatments with regular Alzheimer's meds. Again, about 25% of people who went to these trials didn't have amyloid in their brain. Okay. The good news was, even though it didn't work, the rate of ARIA was low. So that's a good news. Okay, so it was relatively safe. In pre-specified analysis, so the company and Alzheimer's Disease Cooperative Study said, you know what, we're going to do, after the trial's done, combine people, look at mild group and moderate group separately. When they did that, no difference in the moderate group. So meaning, the more advanced you are, less chance, doesn't look like there's any benefit. The mild group, interesting enough, there was. It was small, okay? The benefit is on the order of what you may see with our, maybe about a half to two-thirds of what we see with our current drugs. And that benefit was accumulating over a year and a half or more, suggesting that maybe it was actually not only removing stuff, but actually changing the course a little bit. So because of that, what do they do? They've now done a big study called Expedition 3 in what? Mild. Okay? All right. This is another antibody. Again, negative study. When they did an analysis of just the mild group, and again, a hint, that there could be efficacy. So moderate stage, probably too late. Mild, maybe. Okay. The biggest data that you heard about was this other antibody, aducanumab. Okay. This hit everything by storm. For the first time, they basically were able to show in a very, very small study that if you remove amyloid, see, this is the dose going higher. As the dose goes higher, more amyloid is removed. As the dose goes higher, MMSE declines less. Okay. And overall severity is less. The cautions about this are twofold. It's a very early stage study, very few people, and we've had our hearts broken so many times when we have these small studies. So this is going into a big study now. The other thing we saw with that was a note of caution. We learned a couple of things. As the dose goes higher, okay, more effects. But guess what? More of this ARIA. To the point where in APOE positive folks, 55% of them had these little foci, little areas of edema, inflammation. The good news was, generally, they were transient and then went away. They were mostly asymptomatic. But from this study, they sort of learned a few things about the ARIA rate and the dose. As I mentioned to you, you can have these antibodies, and if we take people right now, all of us make some of these antibodies. And there's a thing called IVIG that we can give to people. Okay, and unfortunately, again, that study was also negative when it was done in mild to moderate. But there's a hint from another study that in earlier stages that there may be some effects. Okay, so what did we learn from these amyloid studies? Okay, we basically learned to look for amyloid positive people, okay, to go earlier in the condition, not wait until they're more severe and more damage has been caused, to go slower. So maybe titrate the dose less and go with a higher dose. So bapineuzumab told us we have to screen. Solanezumab, crenezumab gave us signals that in mild patients there may be some efficacy, maybe. Aducanumab said, you know what? If we push the dose higher, we may actually get more benefit, okay? But we also may get more ARIA, okay? And so we have to balance those risks. So we have to be smarter. So we're iteratively learning how to do what to do in the trials. So I think there is hope. Secondary prevention, what's that? Basically, you can take people who are high risk. So imagine that right now my head is full of amyloid. And I'm not showing symptoms that much. And but I know I'm at risk. So I didn't show you data. But if people who are healthy older folks who have amyloid in their brain, they're much, much higher risk over several years to go on to develop mild cognitive impairment or Alzheimer's. If you're in the MCI stage, the mild cognitive impairment stage, and you have amyloid in your brain, over about 5 years, the conversion for you to progress to actually dementia stage is about 95%. It's a really high risk. So in these secondary prevention trials, basically what we're doing is these are several big trials that are ongoing now. In this one, they're looking for people who are cognitively normal. You're testing normal, but you actually do these PET scans, and there's amyloid in the brain, and trying to give actually some of these medicines to see if there's going to be a change in trajectory. In some of these prevention trials, they're looking for people who have the very aggressive forms of genetic Alzheimer's. They haven't shown their symptoms yet, but they have the gene, which means we just basically know around 52, 53, 54, depending on their family history, when they're going to actually show symptoms more. And they're getting the drugs early, okay? So so there's a whole bunch of these types of studies going on for secondary prevention. This is a list of a whole bunch of different trials, again, different mechanisms that are in later phase. I'll tell you about this drug. Full disclosure, I'm the global PI for this. Which means that I coordinate this trial. It's in about 2,500 people around the world, 30 countries, 29 countries, 450 sites. And we're getting close to finishing the trial. I'll show you phase two data. This is not going to be a cure, but this is a phase two study. Symptomatic, serotonin antagonist. This is a cognitive score, cognition, measuring cognition. Lower is worse. It's added onto donepezil, a cholinesterase inhibitor. This is what happened to placebo. This is what happened to the group that was taking the drug. And the difference there was not only statistically significant, actually it was clinically significant. It was about a 2.3, 2.4 difference in the ADAS-Cog. Okay? Again, very promising, but our hearts have been broken. So we'll see what happens. I can tell you that was just for cognition, but also for factors of daily living, global severity, depending on the analysis, all the trends went the right way. So there's other types of medicines other than the amyloid and tau that are being tested right now. Okay. And this has a cousin too, it's called RVT-101, that's also in testing. That's a little bit farther behind in testing. So based on what we've heard, by the time you get the clinical diagnosis, a lot of stuff's been going on. You have oxidative inflammatory changes, you have misfolding of proteins, you have all this other risk. So ultimately, we're going to be layering medicines on top of each other for prevention, for disease modification, and for symptomatic treatments. And this is a, dang, now where was I going? This is Superman's later years. So we have to know who Superman was and what the expectations are. We can't take Superman and make Superman the way he was before. The other thing we don't know about these meds is where's the sweet spot for these meds? We have to do the right intervention in the right individual at the right time and the right amount, because there's always a sweet spot. Even with the current medicines, there's a sweet spot. People need lower doses of, let's say, donepezil, cholinesterase earlier, and later on they need more, okay? And at some point, there's diminishing returns, and then things can be harmful. So it's very complex, and we need to learn this stuff over time. The other issue is, what are our definitions for saying what's a success? If we say the success is only improvement, guess what? We're deluding ourselves right now, okay? What about stabilization? That's great. Or moderating decline. Guess what? Between symptomatic medicines and disease-modifying medicines, we can probably get a combination of them to slow things down. And why do we diagnose and treat early as possible? I come back to the tenets of medical ethics, okay? Always come back to that. First of all, above all, do no harm. Non-maleficence. So we want to make sure these things are relatively safe in a condition that goes on many, many years. So that's very, very important. Beneficence. Guess what? If we can actually decrease the progression, even if it's the trajectory of clinical, that's a win right now. And we want to diagnose people early to prevent harm and exploitation. Give people autonomy, okay, so that they can make decisions earlier when they're more capable of doing. If they want to go in a clinical trial, they go in a clinical trial. And also for justice, this should be available to everyone. Mr. Osborne, may I be, so my brain is full. And unfortunately, as you can see, as Dr. Henderson said, the brain is small here, so high risk. So what are the challenges? The challenges are it's really complex. We don't know all the how things dynamically interact. We do know that amyloid is critical, that it may be necessary but not sufficient. We don't know the full relationship between this AD pathology and clinical progression that shows the organ failure syndrome of brain failure. We know the synaptic networks and dysfunction are basically required. So we have ways of measuring it now. Sometimes now we can do functional imaging, fMRI even, those PET scans that I showed you, FDG PET scans. We can do, we're doing a study at the Dolby Center where we're gonna be starting off doing kind of EEGs also at the same time while people are doing tasks. So we know that you know what, you could have this thing in your brain, but the synapses may be okay. Once the synapses start not working and the networks start not working well, then you're on this path that's probably not good. And you have to have this balance between vulnerability and resilience. And we may have a big therapeutic window to help people. A cure's very far away, I think, still. And prevention, I think, and multifactorial prevention is very important. So one of the things that we're going to be doing over the next several years is actually starting a cohort of healthy aging and understanding what's successful brain aging. Okay, and through that, we want to do multifactorial interventions, just like the Finns have done through this finger study. And we need to do these things long-term to understand all the determinants to actually help people like Dr. Henderson come up with, to calculate what's actually, more effective. So currently, right now, we have symptomatic medications that are given to people beyond, mild stages and beyond, often in combination. Disease-modifying treatments are probably more likely to be effective when they're given earlier, either in mild AD or even before that, in MCI, to the right people who have amyloid in their brain or tau in their brain. We're still going to need these symptomatic medications. So guess what? Years down the line, 3 years from now, let's say we have these symptomatic medications, we're going to progress, and ultimately they're going to still need to have several combination of medications and cocktails on top of each other to help us. So overall, right now, we basically give these, the cholinesterase inhibitors, memantine, and maybe vitamin E. We're going to layer on top of that, hopefully promising symptomatic medications, disease-modifying medications. Hopefully do these multimodal interventions, but we really have to get better at diagnosing people early, taking care of them early, and individualizing treatments. Can't do this yet. Long time. I can tell you we can do these things. by doing all the things that you probably in this room are doing right now, by taking care of people and families. And that makes a difference. So in conclusion, I think there's no hope, there's no endeavor. And I would look at this, even though I'm a scientist, I'm going to say the glass is more than half full. I think there is a lot of hope. And this was my car in Massachusetts. And it says Cure AD, not see you read. And in and in California, I have the same plate with a space between. So thank you very much.